has tested him. He's gone through the struggle, and he's ready to give you a word. I've been knowing this dude for about 3 years. For about 5 or 6 straight semesters, we took a class together, so we really got to know one another. I want to introduce you to my brother, Reverend Arthur Williams. Hear ye him.
Father, we thank you again for your loving kindness and all of your tender mercies. Over going further, God, I pray right now that you would shine your light from heaven's lighthouse, and not if, but when you find some things that should not be within me. Oh Lord, take it out and strengthen me. God, we bless your name right now because we know that you didn't have to do whatever it is that you did. But because you loved us so much, you allowed all of us to gather back here into your house to celebrate how great you are. Choir just said, God, you are an awesome God, and I concur. Now, God, we pray right now, God, I don't know how much anointing I need for, but whatever amount of anointing you want to pour, God, I'm willing to receive it right now, that you can use me to minister into the heart and to the lives of your people. God, because I stand believing that we all don't have it together. God, I believe that there's some young couple out there, God, embarking on marriage, Father, and they're confused and they need answers. God, some mother, some father is struggling with raising a child. They need answers. God, some pastor may be struggling with leading your people, and they need a word from you on today. God, speak to the heart of your people, God, to the point that when we leave this place, God, we can be better than we were before we walked in. And we'll be careful to celebrate you throughout all of eternity. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. And everybody that loved the Lord with a loud voice said amen. 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 Come on, y'all. Let's put those hands together and celebrate God in this day. I mean, if you really know that it was nobody but God that woke you up, you ought to celebrate him on today. If you know it was nobody but God that has kept you all of your life, you ought to put those hands together. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank God, you may be seated in the presence of God today. We celebrate him because of his excellence. You do know that we serve an excellent God. Amen. A God that does not do anything halfway, but he does everything in excellence. Amen. And God would not have it no other way. Amen. Because one thing I know is that God should have overlooked me. Y'all, I'm one of those that'll be honest with you and let you know that I have faults and failures. But because of his goodness, he's looked beyond all of my faults and saw a need. And he could have called any of y'all, but he chose an old no-good Negro from South Park. Amen. And called to proclaim his gospel. And I am eternally and forever grateful for that. Amen. To the pastor of this church, the under-shepherd, God's chosen angel. Come on, y'all, let's celebrate the person of Pastor Clement Hall. Over here in this city of our, in this district of our city. Amen. 2 years, 2 years. I heard the preacher say last night, a lot of churches don't last 2 years. Amen. Because of everything else that goes up against the church. Amen. But I believe that if you say don't despise small beginnings. And I believe that if it's God the one that has started the ball rolling, God has a way of keeping that same ball rolling. And I believe that you ought to thank God for keeping you all for at least 2 years. Amen. Because it is really a blessing. Amen. And I can stand and be grateful for the fact that I've been a part of you all for 2 years. Amen. You know, the way I look at it is I do such a horrible job the way y'all feel sorry for me and just want me to keep on trying. Amen. Or God is using me in a way to encourage somebody. Either way it go, I say thank you. Amen. And to all these other preachers, man, the guys that I have the honor and privilege of sharing this pulpit with for the past 2 or 3 days. Amen. And to the pastors and to my good friend who comes way from the Woodlands, Reverend Sean Aguilar. Amen. Man, he's shown himself friendly. Pastor Hall, if you just ever need a good preacher, man, this guy right here. I mean, not only give you points, but he give you sub-points. Man, he know how to handle the word of God. Amen. And to all of you, God's children, y'all, it's always good to be back in the house of the Lord. Amen. To see so many familiar and friendly faces. Man, because, you know, I call this in my home. I already told my pastor if I show up at about 11:45, I mean, by 12:30, 12:45, that means I was over at Second Advent over off of Van Fleet and Martin Luther King. Amen. But he gives me permission to come over here because he understands the love that I have for all of you. Amen. And I'm grateful to be here on this last night of revival. We want to hold you long on tonight. We're going to do the best we can to be as brief as possible. But I believe, you know, I know I got some other preachers that can agree with this, but if God has spoken to you in any kind of way, amen, you just want to tell somebody what God has already spoken to you. And God has shared a word with me. And if you don't mind, we ask that you would stand to your feet for the reading of God's word coming from the book of Acts. Amen. The book of Acts, chapter 16. Man, very familiar passage, but we pray that, God will shine a fresh rain, a new light on it. Amen. Acts chapter 16. Man, I want to say happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Amen. Man, I believe some mother ought to celebrate it there because there's not a lot of fathers that still in their child life. Man, if child or mother, if you know that you have a father in the life that helped you take care of all these children, I believe you ought to put those hands together and thank God for the man that God has placed in their life. Amen. You know, I figured I'd get that. Because of Mother's Day, but y'all know y'all bend over backwards for mamas. Yeah, y'all go out there. I mean, y'all stop at every corner side of the road and pick up a basket and go to every Bed Bath and Body Works and do everything for the mama, but for the daddy, happy Father's Day. Amen. But I wouldn't say this, if it wasn't for that man, you wouldn't be here. So at least he did something. Acts chapter 16, y'all, that's enough. Y'all know I'm a little crazy. I can't help it. I told y'all while I was raised. I ain't going to tell y'all the uncles that I had. They were worse than me. But anyway, Acts chapter 16, we'll commence our reading in verse 25 and conclude in verse 30. And when you have it, say amen. And when you get there, you'll find these words, something similar to these I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible. And it reads, "But about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praises to God. And the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there came a great earthquake so that the foundation of the prison house was shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer awoke, he saw that the prison doors opened. He drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, saying, 'Do not harm yourself, for we are all here.' And he called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas." Verse 30, and after he brought them out, he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And for a subject for the time allowed, we would like to use, there is power in prayer and praise. Amen. You may be seated. There is power in prayer and praise. Y'all, I ain't never had too much money at one time. Matter of fact, I heard someone say that a lot of us are only a paycheck away for being up under the bridge. And I believe at times, right now, I know I fit that category. But, you know, just because I might not have it tangibly or financially, you can't stop me from believing that I have it here. Because the truth is, it ain't nothing cheap or broke about me. Man, be honest with you, I've been so poor growing up. Right now, I desire the finer things in life. Even if I can't have it, that don't stop my desire. So oftentimes what I do is I go in places and walk around in stores that I know that I can't afford anything in them. You know, I go to the Galleria to Neiman Marcus. and go to the Gucci section and bother the worker there and say, man, go get me a size 11 in them shoes. And just so I can put my feet in a pair of Gucci's, he go and get a pair of 11s and I walk around the store with some Gucci's on my feet. And say, nah, these not the ones I want. I can't afford every car, but that don't stop me from going to the dealership. Y'all, I love the Dodge Challenger. That's really a car I like. I like that Dodge Challenger. It reminds me of the General Lee on the Dukes of Hazzard. I love it. I love that Dodge Challenger. So I go to Gulfgate Dodge. I ain't go to the used car port, I go to the new car. I walk up with my basketball shorts on and my tank top shirt. Nobody wanted to help me because I looked like I didn't have no money. But I go to the guy, I said, man, I need some assistance. I want to look at a few of your challenges. So he took me to the challenges section. He said, well, what color are you interested in? I said, black. So he took me to where they had like a line of black challenges. I looked at them, and it was like three or four right next to each other. And what I noticed, the difference, they all looked alike. But I noticed that there was a very major difference in the price. There was two different kinds I saw. There was the XT Challenger. It was priced at $26,000. But right next to it was the SRT8, priced at $45,000. I observed the car closely. I'm like, it has the same paint job. It has the same body style. It has the same tint on the windows. Everything looked to be the same. So I asked the tenant, I said, man, why is this car here $26,000 and this car here is $45,000?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he says, because the $45,000 car comes with a whole lot of extra stuff that you don't see on the outside that the $26,000 car don't come in. I said, oh, like what? He says, well, this one here comes with leather seats and that one does not. This one here has a sunroof. And this car does not. And I said, man, so you mean to tell me $20,000 is in leather seats and sunroof?
Yeah.
He said, nah, the biggest majority of the price goes into what's up under the hood.
Yeah.
He said, this here is a V6 at the SXT. He said, but if you lift up the hood up under this SRT8, you find out that it's equipped with an Hemi V8, a much larger engine, which pushes more power. And I don't know who I'm talking to in here today, but a lot of us are operating at a $26,000 level, pushing a V6, mashing the gas, and ain't going no more fast. And we look at the person next to him, we wonder why it looks like they're getting ahead in life, it looks like they're getting everything that they've been praying for. It is because it's what's up under their hood, and they're equipped with more power. And I don't know who I'm talking to in today, but I believe that all of us are power driven. Even in the church today, we look for power. A lot of y'all want to get up under the pastor because you might get a little bit more power. You want to hold positions in the church all because you feel like a position will give you power. But can I let you know today that power, if you're looking for it in that direction, you're looking for power in the wrong direction. But we see here in this book of Acts that Jesus told the disciples to go into the upper room and wait on their power. And you do know what that power was. It says, after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, you shall receive power. And if you read this book of Acts, we often look at it at the actions of the apostles. No, that is not so. The book of Acts is actually the actions of the Holy Spirit. On how the Holy Spirit uses men to get the work of God done. We see that the book of Acts shows us three things about the church. It shows how it develops ethically on how it was more than just the Jews. Then it shows us how it increased numerically because it says that 5,000 was added to the church, 3,000 was added to the church. And it shows us how it was increased geographically because it says that it was started in Jerusalem to Judea, Samaria, to the outermost regions of the earth. And the book of Acts uses all these different apostles, but it highlights two in particular. It highlights in one part of the book, it highlights Peter. You see the works that Peter did. Peter healed someone that was lame. Peter was miraculously freed from jail. Peter did all this stuff.
And Timothy also records the works of Paul. And the obvious thing that I noticed when I read the book of Acts, you see that it shows everything that Peter did great, Paul did great. And the reason that is because the purpose of Luke writing this letter was to show Theophilus that his salvation was just as granted as a Jew's was. And I don't know who I'm talking to in here today, but your salvation can be just as authentic as any person that has been in the church for 30 and 40 years simply because of the work that Jesus Christ has already done in your life. So we're in the Paul section of the book of Acts in the 16th chapter, and we see that Paul and Silas is being led by the Holy Spirit. To where it says here that they wanted to go one way, but the Spirit did not allow them to go. That the Spirit of Jesus Christ led them another way. And Paul has what we call a Macedonian vision to how the Spirit was leading him to Macedonia. So Paul is on his way to Macedonia, and he finds himself in the city of Philippi. Philippi is the head city in this region. And what happened is that Paul, them, they go to church by the banks of the river. And when they go to the church, man, I mean, the Spirit is beginning to move miraculously in their life. They're preaching the gospel, they're praying, and a woman named Lydia, she hears the gospel, she gets saved. Not only does she get saved, but her household gets saved too. Hooray, good job, another win for the church. But as he was going back to the river again, there was a woman that was demon-possessed, and she began to get on Paul's nerve. Paul's nerve to the point of where Paul spoke in, and he spoke to the woman and said, in the name of Jesus, I command that spirit of divination would leave. And immediately that spirit left that woman. Spirit left the woman to the displeasure of her master. You know, one thing I noticed about this book is that the church encountered problems from two people, the Jews and the Gentiles. They received issues with the Jews because they was preaching Jesus Christ, the ones that the Jews rejected. And whenever you see that they're going forth in ministry talking about Jesus, Jews often punish them. But they also received issues from the Gentiles. And one thing I find out about people is when you mess with their money, you're going to have a problem with it. And that is what Paul and Silas experiences right here, because this woman that was demon-possessed and fortune-telling used to make these people a whole lot of money. But Paul heals this young lady. Heals her, and now she's no longer doing what it took for her to do in order to make these other people money. Problem, because now what they do is they go to the magistrates, they go to the chief people of the city, and they begin to beat Paul and Silas. They begin to throw them out and place them on the inside of prison. Paul and Silas was beaten, battered, and bruised. Not only were they placed in prison, but they was placed in the dirty part of the prison. They was placed in the dungeon part of the prison. They was placed on the inner part of the prison. And they weren't just thrown in the prison, but they was given a charge to this jailer, and we'll come back to it later. They was given a charge to the jailer that he needed to watch over them, and in fear of his life, he put chains on their feet so they could not escape. Now these men was beaten, battered, bruised, not only in prison, inner prison, not only on the inner prison, but their feet chained so they couldn't run, but they still had the mind to give God prayer and praise. Prayer is a blessed privilege if it's done correctly.
That's right.
Prayer is not telling God what to do. Come on now, be honest with yourself. You know, oftentimes when you're in distress, you have the tendency to try to tell a sovereign, omnipotent God what to do. God bless me with this man. God bless me with this money. God, I declare and I decree right now that you do this here. You cannot tell God what to do. God does what he wants to do. But I found out that if you pray correctly, there is power in your prayer. Because Jesus says, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your prayer should be, God, manifest on earth what you have already provided for us in heaven. Because it says that if you delight yourself in the Lord, he will give you the desires of your heart. So it's not telling God what to do. And another thing I like about prayer is that prayer may not change your situation. But if you pray correctly, prayer will change you. And that's good news for somebody here that's really looking for change in your life. Quit praying for all these superficial and temporal things and begin to pray for spiritual things in your life, for God to take out that nasty habit that you have in your mind, for God to take out that jealousy, God to take out that envy and all that other stuff, and place this love, place this joy, place this peace right back there. And I believe that when you begin to pray to the Lord correctly, you will see change in your life. That's prayer, but here go praise. Everybody is included. You ain't get it that way. Well, let me say it like this. Nobody is excluded. Everybody in here should give God praise. Why? For Psalms 150 says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let me help somebody right here. We worship and praise really go hand in hand, but I know you've been hearing all your life that he that worship God must worship him in spirit and truth. That is true. That's what the Bible says. So you say, well, since I can't worship God, I might as well stay home and not lift up my hands, not do nothing. But there's a difference in worship and praise, because you worship God for who he is. And the reason a lot of people can't worship God because they don't know who God is. But everybody can give God praise. Everybody can give God. You praise God for what he has done. And then you can also give God praise for what he has not done. I don't know about you, y'all, but that's why I spend a whole lot of my time, because I know I've been places I should not have been. I know I've done things that I should not have done. And I know I've laid down with women that I should not have laid down with. And I did not once get up with HIV or any other STD. And that's why I can come into the house of the Lord, lift up my hands and tell the Lord, thank you that you kept me even when I wouldn't even much keep myself. Everybody got something to tell God thank you for. Because God is worthy of your praise. God created you that you would give him glory. He's worthy of the praise. And we see that in spite of what Paul and Silas has been through, or what they are presently going through, they didn't wait for God to deliver them from their situation. They didn't wait until money got in their account. They didn't wait until the sun began to shine and everything was good in their life. But they prayed and they praised God in the midst of that situation. And that's all I really come to say in my little sermon today, that no matter what you're going through, might not make you boo-hoo. Your little house on the prairie might have turned into a nightmare on Elm Street. Yeah. But no matter what your situation is, you can always talk to God. Yeah. Lift up your hands and give God some praise. Yeah. And it is because, I like this, because it is because they did something that was an effect. It is because they prayed and praised God, God gave them power. Yeah. And I see three movements in this message, are three points in the passage, and then I sit down and be happy all by myself. The first thing I see in this text today, that if you pray and give God praise, that he will give you the power to shake up your situation. Look at what verse 25, it says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praise to God, and the prisoners were listening. Paul and Silas beaten, bruised, battered, and chains on the inner part of the prison. They're not in the population. My brother here can witness to that. Population is when there's a group of people. That's the population. But they was excluded from the population, put in isolation with themselves. But they prayed, they communicated with God, and lifted their voice to the point to where somebody on another level was able to hear them give God praise. But we come into the house of Lord, to the place that God has designated for his people to come in and offer him praise. And that word listening indicates that they were listening intently.
All right.
You know, people know what you're going through. People know the situation. They, you know, it don't take a rocket scientist sometimes for people to know that you're going through something, because we tend to wear how we feel on our face. But what the unbeliever does to us believers is they pay close attention to see how we respond in the midst of our adversity. And truth be told, y'all, and sometimes I'm at blame too, we fail the test. God places us in situations the way if we properly continue to pray and give him praise, people will listen and pay close attention to see how we respond in the midst of our situation. But here's the blessing. They were not praying and praising. But because two men, two leaders of the church, two spiritual brothers were doing what they were supposed to be doing, not only did they get their deliverance, but everybody else got their deliverance too. I don't know what pew that you're sitting on this morning. You may be the only spiritual person on your pew. But if you continue to give God praise, not only will you be delivered, but your pew member will receive their deliverance too, simply because someone that is spiritual decided to bless the Lord at all times. Situation. Not only do I see that he has power to shake up your situation, but we also see that he has, that you, if you pray and give God praise, that he'll give you the power to support your sins. He'll give you the power to support what you've been talking about. He'll give you the power to prove what it is that you've been proclaiming. We're good without verbiage. I'm blessed and highly favored. Too blessed to be stressed. You walk around, y'all tight, y'all can't move. Okay, y'all so spiritual, but spirituality ain't so much as what come out your mouth. But it's so much as how you respond to your brother. Jesus says, by this, men will know that you are my disciples. That you show love towards your brother. And because of their situation and they prayed and praised, God gave them the opportunity to support what they had been preaching about all this time. The love of Jesus Christ. Look what verse 27 says. It says, when the jailer awoke and saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, saying, do not harm yourself. We are all him. Remember, this jailer was given a charge to pay close attention to Paul and Silas. And he knew, according to the custom at that time, that if those prisoners would have gotten away, then they would have been calling for his head. There's a great earthquake because Paul and Silas were praying and singing praises to God. Everyone's chains were loose, but the jailer was asleep on the job. He knows something about that. You know, that's called determination. Sleeping on the job. He was sleeping on the job, and when he awoke from the commotion, he noticed that something was going on. And he says, well, I know that if them main people find out what I've been doing on my job, and that I ain't been doing what I should have been doing, they're going to kill me. So instead of me going through the torture that they're going to put me through, I will just kill myself. But the Bible says, but Paul. Y'all, and I like that, because anyway you see a button that it means things about to turn around. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but you're getting ready. You think you may be coming. contemplating suicide. You may be feeling like it ain't worth living. I'm about to throw in the towel, wave the white flag of surrender. I'm about to jump ship, but the butt is getting ready to come into your life because God has a butt that he wants to offer you, and it's all his word of God. And if you can just get to the word of God will give you confirmation over whatever situation that you're dealing with today. And it says that this same man that this jailer had just beaten, battered, bruised, tormented, threw in prison, placed cuffs on, decided to say, don't kill yourself. If you pray and give God praise, you have the power to support what you've been saying. And Paul at this moment was able to support and forgive those that have mistreated him. And I don't know who I'm talking to here today, but that's a good litany test. Who is it that you are holding a grudge against? Who is it that has done you that bad to where you cannot forgive them? We know what happened just 2 days ago. Caucasian guy walks into an AME church, kills 9 people. It's hard to forgive somebody when they do that. But can I tell you what the scripture tells us to do? Forgive. Why? Because Jesus had no sin. Hung there on that cross. Nails in his hands. Nails in his feet. Falling on his head. People below him that he was dying for was gathering for his clothes. You know what he said? Father, forgive them. And I don't care what it is that somebody has to. That's why you can't celebrate Father's Day, because daddy was a thug. You mad at daddy and you ain't gonna get him again. That's why you can't get back together in your relationship, because somebody cheated on you. That's why you can't get right with your finances, because someone has stolen from you on yesterday. Now you trying to keep everything for yourself today. But God says, let all that stuff go and start brand new right now. And I guarantee your life is a whole lot better. You just learn how to let it go and forgive. And Paul was able because he had a good prayer life. He didn't just start praying once they got in prison, but you see that they was praying all along. The problem is that the only time we pray is when a preacher stand up and pray on our behalf. Oh yeah, God, it's me again. I know I ain't talked to you in 6 days, but I'm still here today. And it's not that God don't hear you, but it's, it weakens your spiritual life. You need to talk to God all day, every day. Paul was able to pray for his enemy. He says, do not harm yourself, for we are all here. So I noticed that not only do you pray and praise right, not only does it give you power to shake up the situation, not only do I see that it gives us the power to support what we've been saying, but it also will give us the power to seek for salvation.
All right.
29 says that, and he called for lights and rushed in and trembled with fear. He fell down before Paul and Silas, and after he brought them out, he said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? The first thing I noticed that this jailer did was call for a light. And one thing I noticed that was still going on today, what happened back then in that jail cell, is that the world is still calling for light. The world needs to see light. The world is dark, but the church is the light. We are the light. We should let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and God get glory. And when God get the glory is when the world asks, what must I do to be saved? Question, have you allowed God to energize your life to the point that someone is influenced by your life? Jesus did not die, save you, just so you can come to Second Advent and do what you always do and just sit down. He saved you to be a light to a dark world that you can go out and make other disciples and bring them into the church. He asked the question, what must I do to be saved? Y'all, I'm like this because I love apologetics. Even in a Christian family, there are different beliefs on salvation. To what some would say that you have to be baptized to be saved. Some say that you have to immediately make Jesus Lord and Savior of your life to be saved. Or that you have to be a member of this particular church to be saved. Or you have to run around 7 times to be saved. Or you have to speak in tongues to be saved. Or you have to do this, do this, do this. You have to work to be saved. And the Bible is clear that you cannot work yourself toward salvation. And this is another passage here that shows us what you must do to be saved. And it says here, it's clear. After the man says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? They said to him in verse 31, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I know, I hear you. James said, even the devils believe and tremble. That's talking about intellectual assent. That everybody has some form, I don't care how much they try to suppress it. They know that there is a God. And that Jesus really is his son. They have an intellectual knowledge of Jesus Christ, but the salvation that I'm talking about is you believe in the life, death, burial, resurrection, and the second coming of Jesus Christ. And if you can really believe that you trust in Jesus Christ for your eternal being, your eternal state, then you are saved. Why the way you said that I must confess with my mouth? You know, those are things that you do that leads, after you've been saved, but on the inside of your heart, you can sit right where you are and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior today. You don't have to run through no loops. You don't have to prove nothing to nobody, but you can have a conversation with God right now and say, God, I don't have it all together. I believe in what you've done for me. Can you receive me unto your own? And Jesus will honor his word and make you his child. When is the last time you got excited about salvation? We get happy about cars, clothes, Caribbeans, credit, companionship, cruises, all that other stuff. But when is the last time you told God, thank you for saving me? I'm saved by God's power divine. Saved by new mercy supply. Life is now sweet and my joy is complete simply because I'm saved. And I thank God today that when I couldn't save myself, Jesus saved me. He died for me. Jesus didn't deserve to be on that cross. He didn't deserve to get treated the way he was treated. He didn't deserve to get the thorns on his head. He did not deserve to get the nails in his hand or his feet. He did not deserve to hang there on that cross. But because of his love for all of us, we can stand up and lift our hands and say, thank you for saving me. And the thing that Jesus did to solidify our salvation is he got up early on the third day morning with all power in his hand. Thank you, Jesus, for your power. Power to forgive my enemies. Thank you for giving me the power to love those that don't love me. And I believe that when you talk to the Lord and continue to bless him with your hands lifted, God will give you the power to do some amazing things in your life. And I thank God today that he continued to show his grace and his mercy on all of us. You know, the good news, church, is that he's on his way back. But the next time he comes won't be like the first time. The first time Jesus came, he came lowly on a donkey. The next time he's coming back, he's coming on the clouds of joy. The first time Jesus came, they placed a crown of thorns on his head. The next time Jesus comes back, he'll have a crown of righteousness that fades not away. The first time Jesus came, he had to stand before Pilate. The next time Jesus comes back, Pilate will have to stand before him. The first time Jesus came, we holler, crucify him. Crucify him. The next time, I hope I don't hear these words, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. For I never knew you. And simply put, Jesus is coming back. And he leaves us a charge that we can do 2 things to receive power. Pray and praise. about you. Talk to the Lord.
Yes.
And begin to give him some praise. May God bless you. Amen. Come on, let's give God a hand of praise.